It's officially December. It's my favorite month of the year. I love all of it. The lights, the festivities, the music, and the fact that it is not so hot outside. I am so thankful for that. Keep this weather on for a long time. Now, how many of you have already sent out your Christmas cards? Let me see a show of hands. Okay, you overachievers over there. How many of you are mad at those who just raised their hands because they've already got their cards all done? Okay, a few of you. How many of you have no plans nor desire to send any cards? Okay, that's been the majority, both services. Okay, we'll see your post on Facebook with your virtual Christmas card on Facebook. Now, if you haven't sent out a card, I'm just going to give you a really free, creative greeting. You can put this on your card. My wife wouldn't let us put this on our card, but maybe yours will. I think you ought to try this. It's a creative, cryptic message to wish somebody a Merry Christmas. And here's the greeting you put on your card. You just list out the alphabets. Okay, and so most likely someone's going to get this card and they're going to be like, this is a really, really strange greeting for this year. And so you list it out and they're going to send you a message. And be like, hey, so what was up with that message? What was up with the alphabets that you listed out? And then you don't respond. Okay, you wait about 3 weeks. Let them live in the suspense for a little while. You wait 3 weeks and then you send this back to them. No L. There's a letter missing between. Some of you are like, Noel, I'm still trying to figure, Noel, Merry Christmas, right? So try it out this year. Something that binds us all together, generations, people all around the world during the season to celebrate the birth of Jesus is carols. Christmas carols. Now, I'm not talking about carols like Santa Baby or Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer or Frosty the Snowman. I have no qualm or beef with Frosty, Rudolph, or Santa. I'm good with all of them. But there are carols that tell not just the spirit of the season, but the story, the truth of what Christmas is about. And they don't just carry the spirit, but the truth of what this season is all about. They are Christmas hymns, like the ones we have just sung this morning, because the incredible truth of Christmas, of God becoming one of us, Emmanuel, God with us, the Son of God becoming Son of Man, you can't just speak about it, you gotta sing about it. Something happens when we speak and then we sing. And these carols are profound truths of the incarnation that must be sung because it creates a soundtrack in the depths of our soul that keep on reminding us and keep on reminding generation after generation that for God so loved the world, he gave, he sent his only son. He was born in the flesh, born of a virgin to rescue us. They must be sung. Just think about the reality that you are singing carols today that you sang as a little child. You're singing the same carols at the same time of the year as your parents and even grandparents sung. The believers of Jesus all around the world from different nations and tribes are singing together these profound truths of what God did at Christmas. It's been said that Christmas is the greatest miracle of all time. In all of history, in all of the Bible, in all of Christianity, Christmas is the greatest miracle. Now, you may be thinking, how can you say that? Like, Easter's a big deal, and we would probably say the resurrection is the greatest miracle that changed all of history. Well, I get that you could argue that because no one else has risen from the dead to never die again. But follow this line of thinking with me. Because Jesus is God, and if we realize he is God, then you expect him to rise from the dead, don't you? Because he's God, he's the author of life, he's the giver of every single breath we have. It makes sense with his nature to rise from the dead. And that makes sense. That's not all that surprising. But you know what is surprising? You know what makes no sense in the human mind? That this almighty God will become a human being. That God will leave the glories of eternity and he will be born an infant, a child. Now that makes no human sense. And not only would he be born, he would live. And then he would die a criminal's death on a cross. Our minds still can't get around the reality of the incarnation. How could God be born as a babe in a manger? It is the most extraordinary miracle that boggles the minds of every human being. This is the incarnation that we are celebrating. And this birth, we're going to celebrate and tell this season by looking at four carols, four Christmas carols that tell the story of this truth. And we're going to unpack the scriptures from which it's written and the theology of hope that these carols bring to us. And the first carol I want to unpack today is, O come, O come, Emmanuel. O come, O come, Emmanuel. I know some of you are hymning that in your, you're humming that in your mind right now, and you can just begin to think about the words of this hymn. Did you know that this amazing hymn was written, the words of this hymn were written in the 8th century, over 1,200 years ago. Now, Taylor Swift is pretty popular today, and she's got a lot of talent, but I guarantee you ain't no one gonna be singing her lyrics in 1,200 years. But this hymn that is immersed in eternal truths about God, generation after generation, we are singing, we are finding joy and meaning in the depth of the words that were written over 1,200 years ago. Now, this hymn was written as part of the Vesper service. What that means is that in ancient times, or in 8th, 9th century AD, the monks who were living in the monastery, they would have these sayings or chants, and they would come together in the evening for a worship service in the monastery, and they would sing or they would recite passages of scripture or verses they had written down as an act of worship to the Lord. And then one Advent season, these Gregorian monks began to write down scriptural truths based out of Old Testament and New Testament passages that describe the titles of Jesus, the Messiah. So they wrote down seven verses, seven titles of Jesus that were descriptive of who Jesus was. And they would, every evening in the last week of Advent, for seven nights, they would recite one of the seven verses of the hymn, O come, Emmanuel. This is how they got ready for Christmas. They would gather and they would recite, they would respond, they would recite and chant these seven incredible titles and descriptions of Jesus. And they did this for hundreds of years. They would just say it. And then in the 15th century, the tune that we have today was given to these words that were written in the monastery in 8th century. And then in the 19th century, this Latin hymn was translated into English, and that's what we have today. I want you to read with me the first verse of this beautiful hymn. It goes like this. Let's read it together. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. Now, I wanted to begin our Christmas season or sermon series with this hymn in particular, because this hymn captures both the joy of the season and the longing of the season. Like, most of our carols are really incredibly celebratory, and appropriately so. This is a season to rejoice and to be glad. But the truth is that real people like you and I, in the season, we don't just have joy. We may be carrying a bit of sorrow. Like, we don't just have excitement, there are yearnings and longings we come into the season with, because real people hurt during the season. They have yearnings, they miss, they grieve. They look at the losses of maybe family members or loved ones or relationships in their life. And so this hymn beautifully captures the reality for you and I this Christmas. Yes, it is a season of joy and excitement and celebration, but there are yet longings that we have that are part of this season. And it situates our joy within the mourning, within the grief that we may feel. O ransom captive Israel, who mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. There are two ways that we can accurately interpret that line. One is to look at that phrase historically, and we can look at it through the 4,000 years of the Jewish people's existence before the coming of Jesus. This community, the Jewish people, the nation of Israel, along those 4,000 years, I mean, they went from captivity to captivity. Foreign nations like Babylon or Egypt or Assyria and Roman Empire, they came and oppressed the people of Israel, and they cried out to God for freedom. As they were taken into captivity, into exile, one nation after another. But they were not just taken captive by foreign nations, they found captivity in their soul by sin. It wasn't just their bodies that experienced this captivity, their soul was in captivity to sin. They couldn't break through the cycles of sin and hatred towards God and towards one another. So there was this 4,000 years of praying and longing for freedom from oppressors that came in and invaded their land. But also, God, would you ransom us? Would you free our soul? May we delight in you again. May we have favor with you again. There were cries of repentance and longing one generation after another. The word ransom simply means a sufficient payment that brings freedom, that delivers people. So for 4,000 years, the people of God prayed, oh God, would you free us, deliver us, save us. And about 700 years before the coming of Jesus, God reveals his plan of deliverance to the prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah would say like this in Isaiah 7, verse 14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. See, the virgin will conceive and have a son, and you ought to name him Emmanuel. This is the long-awaited answer of God. How will God save us? Well, it's not by sending another prophet. It's not about sending an angel or another warrior or human king. God would save his people by sending himself. God was coming in the flesh as Emmanuel, God with us. This is mind-blowing because people are wondering, how are we going to get to God? And God answers with, you can't, but I'm coming to you. Emmanuel, God with us. And this is the prophecy that the angel quotes to Joseph in a dream, as Joseph finds out that his betrothed fiance, his betrothed wife, Mary, is pregnant, and he wants to leave her quietly, divorce her quietly. And an angel shows up in a dream in Matthew 1, verse 23, and the angel says to Joseph, see, the virgin will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us, God is with us. The angel is reciting the prophet Isaiah and said, Joseph, you're in the middle of God's story right now. God is coming to his people through the child in the womb of Mary. Don't leave the story. God has just entered the human history. And Emmanuel is here. God is with us. The rescuer is Jesus. The deliverer is Jesus. The ransom for our freedom is Jesus. And Jesus would say in his earthly ministry, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. I am the ransom. I am the deliverer. I am the price for your freedom. I've come to give you deliverance. Emmanuel, God with us. So we can look at this verse historically and see how God answered this 4,000 years of prayer and longing and misery by becoming one with us. But there's also a second way that we ought to interpret this line, and it's to interpret it in the present. Ransom captive Israel, who mourned in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. How is Israel mourning in lonely exile here? Who is this Israel? Well, at least two times in the New Testament, the Bible teaches that the church of Jesus, the followers of Christ, who've placed their faith in the Son of God, we are the new Israel of God, the new community of God. Now, hear me, I am not saying that the church has replaced Israel. I don't hold that view of theology, because I still do believe that God has a unique plan to fulfill the covenant he has made with the Jewish people. All the way back in Genesis, God wants to save his people and be faithful to his covenant. But what I am saying is that we have been engrafted in to the people of God. We have now been adopted, both Jew and Gentile, people from every walk of life, anyone who places their faith in Jesus. We are the new covenant Israel of God. We are the family of God. So God's promise, his presence, his favor, his salvation isn't limited to one group of people or one ethnicity or one nation. It has been extended to all people who trust in God. We are God's people, his covenant community, the church of Jesus. Amen. That's good news. And the New Testament writers like Peter, they would say, we are saints who are living in exile. We are Israel who mourns in lonely exile here, now, until the Son of God appears. Meaning, though we are saved and redeemed and going to heaven, we still battle the brokenness of this world. And sometimes it's lonely, and sometimes we feel like we're not home, because we aren't. Death still snatches lives away. Injustice still happens. Calamities still strike. Satan still prowls. Sin still lures people away. We grieve, we mourn, we cry. That's what Paul would say in Romans 8. We groan inwardly. Have you had those moments? You don't have words for it, but there's a deep longing. You know that exists. And there's groaning from deep within. Paul says, we groan in Romans 8. We groan inwardly as we eagerly await. As we long for, as we eagerly await the redemption of our bodies, the coming, the return of the Son of God. We are longing in exile here until the Son of God appears. And this Christmas, you may have a deep longing in your heart. I remember when I was a kid during the season, my greatest longing was for snow in Chattanooga, Tennessee, because just the prediction of snow would give us several days off from school. I mean, the roads are so windy and hilly. I mean, just somebody just call out, fake news is fine. We'll get days off, right? We pray for snow. And as I got older, my longings changed like yours did. It became more serious. It became more relational even. Remember one Christmas season, I had this longing for my grandfather to visit America. My grandfather was sort of the faith leader of our family. He was the first to come to know Christ. My grandmother had already passed away years before I was born, but I knew the conditions my grandfather lived in. I just longed, desired for him to come to America. So there we were during Christmas season, waiting for his visa interview, longing for him to come, expecting him to come. Even that day, one particular day, we talked about how amazing it would be when my grandfather would be able to pick up a phone and call Domino's and pizza would show up at the house in like 30 minutes, you know? Like, oh, it's going to be awesome. Or just click one button and the air condition turns on. It's like, whoa, that's going to be amazing. Well, that same afternoon, we got a call from a family member that said that my grandfather has suddenly passed away. It was a longing that was never met. I gotta tell you about my faith, the faith of my grandfather. He actually, in India, he stood up the Sunday before he passed away, and he said, this is my last Sunday here. I'm just announcing it to y'all. Next week, I'm gonna be worshiping Jesus face to face. That's the kind of faith that he had. Now, I wish he told us that, but he didn't. He just told his church that. Sometimes we have longing, and they're met, and it's beautiful when they're met, but there are other times we have deep groanings and desires and longings, and they're never met on this side of eternity, and that's painful. Maybe you have a yearning, a groaning to provide for your family in a different way, in a better way. Maybe you have a yearning for a child that you've been praying for a spouse. Maybe you have a yearning for an adult son or daughter to come back to Jesus. Maybe you see the cavern between you and your spouse and you're just longing for it to be met and filled in. Maybe you're seeing a broken relationship between a parent, a loved one, and you're hoping for reconciliation, even restoration. Maybe you've been battling physical or mental illness and you're just longing for relief. But you see the brokenness around the world and you're saying, God, how long? How long for healing in our world and for peace? If you carry deep longings in your soul, in your heart, you find yourself in the heart of this 1,200-year-old hymn that says we all can have joy and longing at the same time. And yet we're invited and directed to bring our longings to Emmanuel. The greatest longing of our heart is Him. The greatest yearning, the greatest desire is Emmanuel. And we are directed to come and pray, oh, Emmanuel, oh, come, Emmanuel, ransom us, deliver us. The greatest longing we can have in the depths of our heart is for Jesus. And just think about it, for 4,000 years, the people of the Old Testament longed for the Messiah, and then He came. And for 2,000 years, the church, the New Testament people of God, we've been longing for Him to return. Sometimes it feels long, but we've only gone through half the time that our Old Testament forefathers have gone through. For 2,000 years, we've been longing for the return of Jesus. The Bible doesn't just say Jesus come once, but twice. He came once in a manger, lowly, secretive coming. But the next time He comes as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and every eye will see Him. And that's when every bit of our longing is met. And the Son of God appears. Let's keep going in the next few verses of the song, and we'll cover them more quickly. Let's read verse 2 together and say it with me. O come, O wisdom from on high, who ordered all things mightily, to us the path of knowledge, show and teach us in its way to go. This phrase or this verse in the song clues us into the reality that though Jesus was born in Bethlehem, He didn't begin in Bethlehem. His existence did not start in a manger. He has been God from all of eternity past. The one we meet in Bethlehem is wisdom from on high, who has ordered all things mightily. He has created all of life. That's why St. John would say like this in John 1, verse 1 to 3, in the beginning was the Word. The wisdom, the logos, the eternal, infallible Word of God was there in the beginning, and the Word was with God. In fact, the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and all things were created through Him. And apart from Him, not one thing was created that has been created. Jesus didn't begin in Bethlehem. He simply took on human form in Bethlehem. But the one we meet in the manger, He is God, who came from on high, the wisdom of God, the Word of God, the Creator of all things, who came from on high and assumed the nature of a human being, the wisdom of God. Jesus is both the wisdom of God and He is the source of all wisdom. He is the wisdom of God. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24. Speaking of Jesus, yet to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Jesus is the wisdom of God, meaning the plan of God to save the world was not through the elite or the successful or the rich or through a government. The plan of God to save the world was through Jesus. It was through the cross of Jesus. This is the mysterious, gracious plan of God. That's what Paul would refer back to in one instance and say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, nor has it entered into the heart of humanity what God had prepared for His people, for those who love Him. We had no idea. Sometimes we use that verse to talk about our job promotion or the next house we're getting. No, no, no. That verse is talking about the cross. Our eyes couldn't have seen, our minds couldn't have imagined, our heart couldn't have wondered that this is the wisdom of God. This is the plan of God of how He would save the world. And the scripture writer says, yes, Jesus is the infinite wisdom of the Father. The wisdom of God. But not only is He wisdom, He has all wisdom. He is and He has. He is the source of all wisdom. Colossians 2 verse 3 says, in Him, meaning in Jesus, are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. If you find yourself searching for direction, longing for guidance, wanting clarity, come to Jesus. He is a fountain of wisdom. The treasures of the wisdom you're searching for is found in Jesus. That means that there in the manger, we don't just find a Savior who sacrifices for us. We find a Lord who invites us to reorient our whole life around His wisdom, His truth, His life, death, and resurrection. to turn away from our wisdom and to turn to him who is wisdom, who has wisdom. Verse 3 reads like this, and let's say it together loudly. O come, great Lord of might, who to your tribes on Sinai's height in ancient times did give the law in cloud and majesty and awe. Several times in the New Testament, the writers will point back to how Jesus shows up, the pre-incarnate Jesus shows up in the Old Testament in moments like at the Exodus, that Jesus, Paul, or the writer of Hebrews says, led the people of God out of Egypt. Well, there on Mount Sinai, when people beheld the glory of God, the all-consuming holiness of God, the writers of Scripture said that was the holiness, the greatness of Jesus we beheld. Jesus was there all along in the story. Jesus would say about himself in Revelation 1, verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, the one who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. That's where we get the phrase Lord of Might. It's because Jesus said himself about himself, I am Lord Almighty. So what that means is the one you meet in the manger, he is more than what meets the eye. He is more than what meets the eye. The one you find in this form, helpless, crying, he is the Alpha and the Omega, beginning and the end. The one who was, is, and is to come. He is Lord of Might. And you can't have wonder during the season until you realize this. So the incarnation is about a holy, glorious, awe-inspiring God, humbling himself to the point of human infancy. Son of God becoming son of man. The Ancient of Days becoming an infant. The timeless one, the one who exists in inapproachable light, now being carried in the arms of a teenage girl. The almighty, all-powerful, omnipotent God becoming so helpless. In fact, the Almighty becoming all needy. The Almighty becoming all needy, all powerful, becoming so needy. Oh, the one you meet in Bethlehem is more than what meets the eye. You're encountering majesty in the manger. You're meeting holy in the lowly. You're seeing a God who humbled himself to this point, and yet in all of his humility, he is still almighty. That's why when you come to him, when you see him this season, you can only do what the shepherds and the wise men did. They would do whatever it took to meet him. Once they saw him, they bowed down. They gave the most precious gifts they could, and they worshiped him. They gave honor and worship. They gave their life. Somehow they knew that this child in a manger is the Lord of might, the Almighty. Verse 4, let's read verse 4 together. O come, O branch of Jesse's stem, unto your own and rescue them. From depths of hell your people save and give them victory o'er the grave. Over the grave. This is a title that we often don't think about when we come to Jesus, the branch of Jesse's stem. I have yet to find a Christmas mug with this on it or a card. The branch of Jesse's stem. It's an odd title, but when you realize the beauty of this, it's a profound imagery of who Jesus is. Jesse here is Jesse, the father of David, and Jesus came through the lineage of David. And the prophet Isaiah writes about this phrase in Isaiah 11, verse 1 and 2. Isaiah says, then a shoot will grow from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from its roots will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, a spirit of wisdom and understanding, a spirit of counsel and strength, a spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. When Isaiah is writing this, it's hundreds of years after King David. And by the time he is writing this, the house of Jesse, the lineage of David, the nation of Israel, they are desolated and scattered. They are spread across the whole world in exile, in captivity, and there is no life among them. There is no hope among them. They seem like a tree stump. There's nothing life-giving about a tree stump. You're not picturing greenery or leaves or branches coming out of a tree stump. No, no, no. A tree stump has been mowed down, cut down. You sit on a tree stump or use it to build furniture. No sign of hope. It is lifeless. It is dry. It is dead. And Isaiah says, this is the people of God. This is the story of the ancient people. They are lifeless, hopeless. But then he says, but there is coming one, a shoot from the branch of Jesse, that emerges out of lifelessness and dead and dry places, and he will bear much fruit. Here's an imagery you can think of. A tree stump with all kinds of rings around it, then a small, infant, life-giving plant that shoots forth. That's what Jesus does to our human story. Keep that image up. I imagine maybe as you look at your own soul and you survey your own life, there are rings that tell a story. They tell a story of pain, grief, betrayal. Maybe each of those rings will talk about its self-inflicted wound or another's inflicted wound. And you can't have wonder again. You don't feel joy. You don't feel life on the inside. And if that's you, I need you to grab a hold onto this imagery from the prophet Isaiah when his whole people, his whole entire nation was lifeless, dead, and hopeless. And he says, the story of Jesus is about a shoot coming out of a stump. It's about life emerging from what was lifeless, hope bursting forth from what seemed hopeless. And the story of Jesus is that when he comes into your heart, when he comes into our life, his life breaks through the longevity of the pain you've been feeling. His hope breaks through to the guilt and the shame you've been crippled under. His life springs forth forgiveness and redemption and reconciliation with God and even reconciliation with one another. He is the branch that comes out of a stump. It's redemption. It is life from the dead, hope from the grief and despair. It is the story of Jesus. He is a branch coming out of Jesse's stem. Verse 5, let's read this together. O come, O key of David, come and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe for us the heavenward road and bar the way to death's abode. The key of David is found in Old Testament passages, but it speaks of the authority that one has, the authority to open doors and to close doors. And oftentimes in Old Testament, rulers wore the key and was called the key of David on their shoulders. And I just want you to think about how Isaiah says, the government will be on his shoulders. In Isaiah 9, the government, the universe, the authority of the world is on the shoulders because he, Jesus, is the key of David. And Jesus says in Revelation to John, Revelation 3, verse 78, write to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. Not Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, but another Philadelphia. Thus says the Holy One, the true one, the one who has the key of David, who opens and no one will close, who closes and no one opens. Jesus, for all eternity, holds the key of David, holds authority, holds power, and he closes the door to death for those who've trusted in him. He opens the door to heaven. Woo. He grips you from hell, and he locks the door behind you, and he brings you safely into the presence of God to himself, and he locks the door behind you, not to trap you in, but so that no one can snatch you out, so that nothing can separate you from his love. Not life, nor death, not angels, not demons, not principles. Nothing can separate you. And with the key of David, he holds you securely in the palm of his hand. You are the apple of his eye. And he says, I've got you. I've got the key of David, and I've got you. This is who Jesus is, one with all authority and power, rescuing us from hell and securing us on the road to heaven. Verse 6, let's read it together. O come, O bright and morning star, and bring us comfort from afar. Dispel the shadows of the night and turn our darkness into light. Have you ever had a long night? You just couldn't wait till the sun came up. I remember with Avery, we had such a hard time with our sleep schedule, and we did everything. I mean, my wife's a pediatrician. Literally, we did everything. Even anointed her with oil. Like, please, Lord, just give us one night of sleep. Like, 2 years old, like, please, Lord, let her sleep. Sometimes we couldn't wait till the morning. Maybe you've had nights where you fight the dark night in your soul. Panic, anxiety, worry. And you would rather be tired during the day than be at panic at night. And you're just waiting for the dawn. The scripture writers will say, Jesus is the dawn. He is the bright and morning star that comes out of a weary, lonely, fearful night. In fact, Zechariah begins to prophesy in Luke chapter 1, verse 78, and he says it like this: because of our God's merciful compassion. I want you to hang on to that. When you feel the darkness of the soul, God's compassion is extended towards you. Not blame, not guilt, not shame. He's coming to you with compassion, merciful compassion. And Zechariah says, the dawn from on high will visit us. The dawn is day spring. The morning star will visit us. Why? To shine on those who live in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Jesus is the morning star who meets us in the weary nights of our soul to rescue us from the shadow. And even if it doesn't feel like rescue, he comes in and he stays with you through the night hours until you see him as the morning star. The last verse reads like this. Let's read it. You're getting tired on me, so hang in with me. Last verse, let's read it. O come, O King of nations, bind in one the hearts of all mankind. Bid all our sad divisions cease, and be yourself our King of peace. Oh, come, King of nations. You see a beautiful microcosm of this as the wise men from the east, or called the kings from the east, begin their journey. East simply representing the nations outside of Israel. They're coming from the east. And sometimes we think they're just three wise men. No. That's nowhere in the Bible. They brought three gifts, but they were not just three wise men. I believe there's an entourage of kings from the east traveling because they saw a star, and for years they're traveling on foot, trying to find what they call the King of the Jews. But oh, they didn't know that he was actually their king. The kings come, and they finally find Jesus, and they give him the most precious gifts. It was a fulfillment of Psalm 2 and other passages, especially in Revelation, that talk about how every world leader, every king, every nation will come and offer their gifts at the feet of Jesus. They will see that he is King of kings. He is the perfect king. He is the most powerful king, the Lord of lords. He's a king of nations. The songwriter says, he removes the sad divisions and binds in one the hearts of all humanity. Perhaps today you are running up against the walls of division, relationally, culturally, socially, nationally, internationally, politically. There are walls of division. Nations rising up against each other. And the scriptures tell us that there will only be peace when we see Jesus as the King of peace. Only he can bind in one the nations and make our hearts one. Isaiah calls him the Prince of Peace. And we see the ultimate fulfillment of this in Revelation 7:9, where there around the throne of Jesus are gathered every tribe, nation, language, and tongue. And they have one song. They're singing, salvation belongs to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Salvation is him. He is our ruler. He is our king. He is the King of the nations. Oh, the King of Nations, would you come and bid and remove away the sad divisions of our heart? We're going to end with this hymn in just a moment, but this hymn is a call and response, as it was for hundreds of years. It's a call and response. It gives words to some of the deepest longings in our heart, and yet invites us to rejoice in Emmanuel. Caleb reminded me this week that this hymn is written in the minor key, which indicates something that's unresolved or unfinished. It's written in the minor key, meaning the story is not yet over. I think that's a powerful image of a kingdom that Jesus brought, but it's not fully here yet. It's already, but not yet. We still feel the longings of our soul, and we're living in the between time of Jesus coming once and knowing he will come again. We're living in the in-between time, but the story isn't over. God is still unfolding his plan to save people, to reconcile people to himself. It's in the minor key. There are unresolved tensions, just like you have unresolved tensions. Yet in the tensions that we face, we're still invited with this recurring refrain, rejoice, rejoice. Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice. Why? Because even though the story isn't over yet, Emmanuel is here now. He's not just here yesterday and won't just be here tomorrow. He is in the middle of the journey with you, in the middle of the story. For those of us in this room who are in need of deliverance from the captivity of our soul, perhaps your past, your future, your present is bringing such a weight on you, in your soul. Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. He is our deliverer. There's no one else who can deliver you, only him. He is the rescuer of our soul, Emmanuel, God with us. We can't go to him without him coming to us. He is with us. For those of you who need guidance, wisdom, direction, he is wisdom from on high. And he's asking you, would you surrender your own wisdom? Would you embrace me as wisdom? Would you find wisdom in me? For those of you who are feeling powerless and unable, you don't know if you can keep going on. Jesus is the Lord of might. He has the power you need, the strength you need, and it's his life in you that infuses courage, ability, strength that you don't have on your own. For those who are dealing with the rings of sorrow and pain, and life seems dry and even dead, Jesus is the fresh branch that stems out of our tree stump. He is life, hope, and meaning. For those who wish to fear death no longer and journey safely heavenward, he holds the key of death, closes the door to death, and opens the door to eternity once and for all. For those who battle the dark soul, the dark night of the soul, he is light, he is meaning, he is compassion, he is companion, he is the bright and morning star. For those who wrestle with the sad divisions of our soul and our relationships, he is King of Peace, the Prince of Peace. So we can rejoice. In fact, we can rejoice again. Rejoice, rejoice. Why? Because Emmanuel has come, and Emmanuel is coming. Amen. Would you stand with me? Hallelujah. Let's sing. Let's worship this song.